brings as we believe in him. Father, I thank you for that, and we celebrate the gift of salvation today. We pray for those that are going to be watching online today. We pray for those that are in this room, and God, that we would be challenged, that we would be encouraged, and that we would leave here stoked and hungry and thirsty to know your word all the more and to see your power in accordance with the Holy Spirit that dwells in those of us who are believers. Father, if there's anyone here watching this weekend or the weeks to come, as this will be on YouTube, who need to know Jesus as their Savior, I just pray that, again, you will convict hearts, the Holy Spirit will convict hearts, and that they will place their faith and their trust in Jesus Christ. Father, we ask prayers for our brother today physically. Lord, we know his legs are bothering him a bit. Lord, we also know that he's got traveling to do, and that can be weary and tiring, but we just thank you, and we ask that you just give him an extra shot of energy here this morning, and a clear mind and a peaceful heart, knowing that he's among friends and among members of the body of Christ. Lord, we're here to draw closer to Jesus, and I thank you for our brother, Jacob Prasch, and his gift and ministry in this area that you have given him, never to a man, but through a man, to the body of Christ. Father, may you be glorified today in all that we hear, say, and do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, dear friends. Greetings in Jesus. Wonderful to be with you here in Ohio, and how good of you to miss the football game in order to be with us today. I know people in Ohio like football. I live in England. I've come to like rugby. But I know football is very important to you guys, and you chose me over a quarterback. I'm thrilled. I was telling our brother in the millennium I'm going to have leg muscles like a quarterback. In the meantime, I hop around on crutches. Some people are curious as to what happened to me. Well, I almost snuffed it last year this time. And, well, let's just say, despite the prayers of many people, I survived. The Lord is indeed gracious. I don't know how long we've got the first session. We have an hour and 15 minutes the first session? Okay. We may have to do this in two parts, otherwise we'll just do it in one and then a separate subject for the second. We're looking this morning at the restrainer. The restrainer. Who is the restrainer? Who or what is the restrainer of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2? Quite a thing. Let's go to that passage, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. But what I'm going to do today is, instead of looking at the English primarily, we'll look at some of the translation. I'm going to focus on the original Greek language, and I'll translate the original meaning as best as I can from the Greek. Okay? We want to focus on this passage of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I'll look at it in English first, and then I will highlight the backgrounds from the Greek text of verse 3 particularly. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now we request you, brethren, with regard to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him. The Greek word there is episunagage. Epi, the prefix meaning around. Episunagage, get the word synagogue. Synagogue is not a Hebrew word, it's actually a Greek word. The episunagage. And it's also a term used in James' epistle for the church. The church is actually called the synagogue. In the epistle of James, the episunagage, our gathering together to him, that you may be not quickly shaken from your composure or disturbed either by a spirit or a message or a letter, as if from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Now that right away tells us when the Lord comes, that triggers the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is something that is distinct from other eschatological events. It is something that the faithful church is not here for. The day of the Lord corresponds to the time of wrath. We are not appointed unto wrath. One of the mistakes our pre-tribulational brethren make is they give themselves some kind of license to make two Greek words synonyms, which are not. They take the word for tribulation, thlipsis, and they make it a synonym for the word orge, which is wrath. They are two different words in the original Greek, and they mean two entirely different things. Pre-tribulationism always depends on presuppositions. It's like Darwinism. Darwinism only makes sense if you take on the presuppositions of Darwinism. That particle deterioration and entropy have always happened at the same rate now, always happened at the same rate as they do now. Well, the scripture tells us there were changes to the biosphere with the fall of man and with the flood that entropy increased. Darwinism can only make sense if you take on board the presupposition. Well, pre-tribulationism is the same. It depends on a series of presuppositions to have plausibility. You must take on the presuppositions. But if you question the presuppositions, just like Darwinism, it begins to implode. Wrath is one word. Tribulation is another. Jesus said you'll have thlipsis in the world. We'll always have tribulation. However, we're not appointed unto wrath. The day of the Lord is when the wrath of God is unleashed. Now, I know most of you know this, but we have people watching on live streaming, and we have to take them into consideration, of course. Let no one in any way deceive you. It will not come unless the apostasia, the apostasy, comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. Now, that word there is not really lawlessness in the Greek. You can translate it that way based on what comes in verse 7. The word there in Greek is the man of sin, or the son of perdition, the man of sin, the son of perdition, or of destruction. And it speaks, of course, of the coming of the Antichrist. We can see a basis to refer to him as the anthropon anomon, the man of lawlessness, based on verse 7. That is the one who is without law. Only now he who restrains him, katiko, the restrainer. Who is this restrainer that restrains him? Well, there have been different theories propagated by different people at different times. The Protestant reformers took a historicist view of end-time prophecy. They were partially right, but they made it almost exclusive. They didn't look for some end-time antichrist. They simply saw the Roman papacy and the Pope as the antichrist. Therefore, in their thinking, of some of them, if you can believe it, it was the pagan Roman Empire that restrained the antichrist. Once the pagan Roman Empire ceased to exist, the papacy came to power after Constantine relocated his capital to Istanbul, to Constantinople. I think it's a bit daft, but that's what these people believe. Others say it was the Roman Empire up to the time of Nero, but the Antichrist will be Nero reincarnated. This was the belief of some of the early Christians, not early in the sense of the time of the apostles, but the time after that, the early patristic era. This were their beliefs, that the Roman Empire is the katiko, is the restrainer. I would dismiss those things, but of course it's a separate subject. I was one of a number of people, and I was not the only one, and I was certainly not the first one, that before the term pre-wrath was coined, first by C.S. Lovett, and then by Marvin Rosenthal, a nice Jewish boy who I've met a few times, and the late Robert Van Kampen, the investor who I knew, before those guys came along, I was one of a number of people, and I was, again, not the only one and not the first, by no means, who stated that the rapture is between the sixth and seventh seals. I always believed it. Before pre-wrath was coined, I believed it, but so did other people. Not a lot of people, but some people did. I also made it clear we have to draw a distinction between tribulation and wrath. I also made it clear then, at that time, that based on 2 Thessalonians and certain other passages, the rapture and the resurrection, which are concurrent, the rapture, the harpazo, and the resurrection, the anesthesia, rapture plus resurrection equals episunagage, our gathering together to be with him. The dead in Christ rise first. Okay, I always said that it's not going to happen until the faithful believers know who the Antichrist is. I always believed those things. And I was very happy when these pre-wrath people showed up, and some of them contacted me and wanted to talk to me because they were curious how somebody who was not a cessationist, who believed the gifts of the Spirit still operate, could believe such a thing, because they dismissed all charismatics and Pentecostals as biblically ignorant. And they were curious as to why somebody who was not a cessationist could have had these views even before they did. And I, again, was not the only one by any means. Nonetheless, that was the beginning. What the pre-wrath people say about the timing of the rapture is correct. What they say about the need to identify the Antichrist before the rapture will happen is correct. They also would agree there's a difference between wrath and tribulation. They're correct. They are mostly right in most of what they say. They are mostly right in most of what they say. There is one place that I am quite convinced, in fact, I'm absolutely sure, they are mistaken. The identity of the catechol, of the restrainer. Now, I see pre-wrath people as my comrades. I don't see them as adversaries. I don't even want to see the pre-trib people as my adversaries. Unfortunately, a lot of them don't see it that way anymore. If you're not pre-trib, they write you off as some kind of a heretic. Well, let's continue looking at this. They're wrong about this. They say that this restrainer is an angel, most likely, or in some cases, most certainly, the archangel Michael is restraining. There are two problems with this, which is purely speculative. Purely speculative. The first problem is the term ketikol, restrainer, is never applied or used in any context with Michael. Neither in the Septuagint, in the book of Daniel, nor in the book of Revelation, he's never called a restrainer. Never. Secondly, far from preventing the Antichrist from coming to earth and far from preventing Satan from coming to earth and indwelling the person of Antichrist, Michael kicks Satan out in a battle, a celestial battle in heaven. Instead of preventing him from coming, he causes him to come. There is a logical and textual inconsistency in what they're saying, even though they're mostly right about other things. Now, another thing they're right about is this, post-tribulationism. Most people who say they're post-tribulation mean at the end of the 7 years. The tribulation is not the entirety of the 7 years. Broadly speaking, we may break down the final 7 years, that is the 70th week of Daniel's vision, into three primary phases. The first is the beginning of birth pangs. There you have tribulation with a small t. It'll simply be a amplification of the kind of tribulation believers have always had. Then it will go from the beginning of birth pangs to the great tribulation, the megathlipsis. Okay. Once the episunagoge takes place and the faithful church is removed, then it goes into the day of the Lord, the day of his wrath. Okay. Believers are not here for that. Okay. So you can say that post-tribulationism is correct, as long as you understand that post-tribulation does not mean at the end of the 7 years. This is a big problem. Different believers who believe in the rapture mean different things by the same terms. This becomes extremely complicated. It's a phenomena of the age in which we live. For instance, whenever you deal with any kind of a Gnostic, any kind of a mystic who has a mystical interpretation of Christianity, you're always going to have this phenomena. They're always going to use the same terms you do that mean something different by it. I remember many times witnessing in Maui to the New Agers in Maui on the beach, and they run around with naked with tattoos, smoking pot, and chanting at the sun and all this stuff. You witness to them, and you tell them, I saw the light. Well, they'll tell you they saw the light, the cosmic illumination of the inner self. You tell them you were born again. Well, they were born again. They're reincarnated. You tell them you believe in sin. Well, they believe in sin. And that's giving place to negative vibes, man, you know. You tell them you believe in the Holy Spirit. Well, they believe in the Spirit, the Zeitgeist. To them, it's the spirit of the age. They'll use the same terms you mean. They'll use the same terms but mean something else by it. People who should know better, scholars and theologians, when you have these ecumenical forums between Jesuits, between Roman Catholic scholars, and so-called Protestant ones, the Protestant will say, oh, we're saved by grace. And the Jesuit will say, oh, yes, we're saved by grace. And they'll shake hands and say, oh, the Reformation was a mistake. We're all one now. The problem is, in Hebrew, grace is chesed, God's mercy in the covenant. In Greek, it's charism, gift. In English, it's undeserved favor. So the Protestant or the evangelical whatever is thinking of grace as something unearned, unmerited. To a Roman Catholic, grace is an ethereal substance earned by sacraments. They can both agree to save by grace, but they have two different definitions of grace. This is a phenomena of the age in which we live. People mean different things by the same terms. And that is certainly true in discussions concerning the rapture. Now remember, the truth of the return of Christ, the episunagage, the harpezo, the doctrine of the rapture, is under attack by means of spiritual seduction as never before in the history of the church, in modern times certainly. Certainly post-Reformation history, never as never before. What you have are people who mock the rapture and deny it. People like Rick Joyner, they deny it. People like Mike Bickle, who say the rapture of Elijah was God's judgment on Elijah, the rapture's a judgment. Or, you know, Gerald Coates in England is another one. The rapture's a fantasy and a myth. And they even make fun of it, beam me up Scotty, like in Star Trek and things like this. You know, Rick Joyner, you know, they think it's of the devil. Then you've got people like Rick Warren, who says avoid the subject, it's a diversion. Jesus commanded us in the imperative and reiterated it. Be alert, be alert, be alert. Now Rick Warren says keep away from it. Who cares what Jesus said? We should listen to Rick Warren. Who needs the New Testament if you have the purpose-driven lie? This is what's happening. The doctrine itself is under attack. Unfortunately, those who believe the doctrine are increasingly attacking each other. As many of you know, my plea to my pre-trib brethren and others who have differing views than I do, including to a degree some pre-wrath people, although they're very close to what I believe, is this. This is an important subject. In the spirit of Christian fellowship, we need to prayerfully come together and deal with this as a matter of discussion, not as a matter of division. The debate, the fight, the Kampf, is with those who are denying the rapture, not with those who believe it. Those who believe it need to convocate. I'm all in favor of symposiums. I'm all in favor of scholars and theologians who believe in the rapture coming together, seeking the Lord for illumination on this subject. Unfortunately, people have drawn battle lines over it that never should have happened. And people not subscribing to the agenda have become ostracized. Some very serious things have transpired in this light. Again, I do not say this by way of attack. The man was a friend of mine. I actually liked him personally. We did conferences together. He went to be with the Lord recently, was Tim LaHaye. Nice man and a sincere man. He was not of the persuasion we have to worry about the Antichrist. So when a real Antichrist, Sun Myung-moon, the Korean cult leader, who said he was the Lord of the second advent. He said that he was the return of Christ, that Jesus failed in his mission. He's come to succeed when Jesus failed. This was Moon. Okay. When Moon was finally prosecuted for fraud by the federal authorities, Tim LaHaye tried to organize 300 evangelical leaders to voluntarily go to federal prison in solidarity with Moon, with an Antichrist. Well, what? This is crazy. Why would you do that? They become delusional. They don't take the text literally. Watch out for Antichrist. Let he who has wisdom count the number of the beast. Oh, that's for the tribulation saints. It doesn't concern us. If the tribulation saints had wisdom, they wouldn't be here either. They would have been raptured with the rest of us. But he actually gets on a platform with the Moon, and these guys, Jerry Falwell did the same thing. Jerry Falwell called Moon an unsung hero. A man who says he's the return of Christ, is it? You couldn't make this stuff up. The pre-trib camp is imploding. It's caving in on itself. You have people like Thomas Ice teaching that the apostasia, the falling away, the departure, is not the falling away from the faith, which the context supports, and which the way the term and the underlying term, apostasmai in Greek, is used elsewhere in Timothy, I'm sorry, in the New Testament. He says, no, the apostasy is the rapture itself. Now, other pre-trib people, major pre-trib people, oppose him in this. Dr. Mark Hitchcock and others, they oppose him. They're divided against themselves. You've got another one named David Reagan, a major, major pre-trib figure who's an annihilationist. He says if there's such a place as eternal hell, God is not a God of justice. You understand, these people are divided against themselves. They are not a monolith. They remind me of Islam. Islam needs a common enemy to put on the hollow air of unity. Islam depends on jihad against the infidel. As they say in Gaza, first the Saturday people, then the Sunday people. First we're going to murder the Jews, then we're going to murder the Christians. Why? Because if they don't have a common enemy, they're going to murder each other. Most jihads are Muslims killing other Muslims. They need a common enemy to have a unity, to have the doctrine of Ummah that the Quran teaches, that Muslims are one. Well, they're not one. Their history shows they're not one. History shows that they're what the scripture says. Esau's sword will be against his brother, and Ishmael's seed will be divided. They need a common enemy. Well, I see pre-trib people behaving the same way. They have to have a common enemy in people who are not pre-trib because they're so divided against each other. Fundamentally, they no longer believe the same things among themselves. You've got pre-trib people again like Thomas Ice, who says contemporary events in the Middle East don't fulfill prophecy. Other people, pre-trib, say that that's insane. Of course these things fulfill prophecy. There's no unity among them. And they've become seriously desperate in the lengths they will go to defend these things. I was a close friend, and I loved Dave Hunt. This never would have happened if he was still with us. And he's now with the Lord, the Brian Call. His successor, Tom McMahon, again, I know him. I'm not against these people. Understand, I'm not against these people personally. Saying, well, there's no pre-trib rapture taught anywhere in Scripture. We agree explicitly. But we don't just get doctrine from what's literally stated. We get doctrine from what we extrapolate. In other words, you get doctrine from eisegesis, not from exegesis, from reading things into the text that doesn't say based on people's opinion. And he goes on and he says, it's like the doctrine of the Trinity. It's nowhere taught directly in the New Testament. We extrapolate it. That would be music to a Jehovah's Witness's ears. What, John 14 and John 17 are not in your New Testament? The martyrdom of Stephen is not in your New Testament? The doctrine of the Trinity is plainly stated. The Great Commission, not names, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The dynamic of the Trinity and how the three persons interoperate is taught directly by Jesus in John's Gospel. But he begins teaching this Jehovah's Witness teaching that the Trinity's not there, we have to extrapolate, as a means to defend pre-trib. Their scholar, John Wolfert, former president of Dallas Seminary, admitted in his book on the rapture, there is no passage that teaches pre-tribulationism directly. We have to glean it. You can glean anything. There's people in Kentucky picked up rattlesnakes. You can glean anything. Unbelievable. So they get to this thing of the catecho, the restrainer. It becomes a big problem and a huge issue with these people. Whoops. What does the Word of God say concerning it? Let me read verse 3. Mitis humas ekaratsi kata me edina tropan hoti ian me elte. Ian me elte. We'll come back to that term. He apostasia proton kai apocalypse. We get the word apocalypse, the unveiling. Ho anthropos tes harmatis, the man of sin, not the man of lawlessness. Some translations put lawlessness, which can be justified again if you look at verse 3 in light of verse 7, but that's not what it actually states in the original canon, okay, and in any manuscript. Okay, the man of lawlessness, the man of sin. Ho son o Apollos, Apollyon, like in Revelation, the son of destruction. Know any you should be seducing or deluding. Know any you should be deluding or seducing according to the tropon, method or manner. Now we translate this, let no one deceive you by any means. We use the term by any means colloquially. In the actual Greek, it means there's going to be methods that people are going to attempt to use in order to persuade you to believe what they're telling you. They're going to have some kind of method. Don't be taken in by any method. One method is eisegesis instead of exegesis, trying to extrapolate doctrine instead of going by what's flatly stated. Last time I was in Columbus, I explained this, the difference between eisegesis and exegesis. You can only base a doctrine on what you can take out. That is one method they are going to use. Now let's continue looking at this. Again, the key term I want to look at in this particular passage is ian me elthi. If ever, no may be coming. If ever, no may be coming, which is aorist active third person singular. In other words, unless this happens, that can't happen. Unless this happens, that can't happen. Specifically, unless this person comes, the man of sin or the man of lawlessness, unless this person comes, Jesus can't. The coming of the Lord, the episunagage. Okay. They have to do monkey tricks with what the text plainly says. They have to use some other method of hermeneutic or exegesis to get around the plain meaning. They all have to. And again, it's presuppositional. You have to take on the presupposition. A philosopher would call this something, well, put it to you this way. It can't mean what it seems to mean, So therefore must mean something else, reductio absurdum in Latin. It can't mean what it seems to mean, therefore it must mean something else, and you have to take that on board as a presupposition. That's the method, okay? That is the method. Now, how do we interpret this, and how does this interpret other scripture? Let's talk for a moment about the New Testament figure who the Holy Spirit inspired most to write about the return of Jesus. It is without doubt the Apostle John. The Apostle John wrote more about the last days than Paul or than Peter or any other figure, even though the others wrote about it. James, they all wrote about it. But John wrote more, author of the Apocalypse, the book of Revelation. Most pre-trib people, and in fact the pre-trib research council, they argue strongly, as I would, that John was the author of the book of Revelation. But one of the things that Mark Hitchcock cited in his debate with Hank Hanegraaff is patristic history from the church fathers. Going back to the earliest line after the apostles, the people who got their doctrine directly from John, of the Papias, Hegesippus, Irenaeus camp, okay? The people who got their doctrine directly from John at Ephesus at the end of the first century. They all say that John never taught pre-trib. They all believed that the Antichrist would have to be identified before the rapture. Now, they got a big problem. On one hand, they're citing this historical source as credible to set John's authorship of Revelation. But that same thing they're citing shows the early church did not believe in pre-trib. They got a problem. They got an inconsistency within themselves, and they can't deny this. Well, he wrote Revelation, but John also in 1 John deals extensively with the subject of Antichrist, doesn't he? Yet, in his gospel, there is no Olivet Discourse. There is no equivalent of Matthew 24 and 25. There's no Luke 21 or equivalent of Luke 12 or Luke 13. There's nothing like that in John's gospel. God saves John to write Revelation. He doesn't have an Olivet Discourse. What John's gospel does have is a punctuation throughout the book of eschatological or end-time references, things that are like linchpins when you spot them. They hold other things together. They're comprehensive and systematic, but not in the way the synoptics were written. Let's look at just one example. Turn with me, please, to the Gospel of St. John, chapter 5. Verse 43. I've come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, you will receive him. Now that is a prophecy about the Antichrist. It tells us that unbelieving Israel will accept the Antichrist as the Messiah, having rejected the true one, they'll accept the false one. It had a partial historical fulfillment in the second century with somebody called Simon Bar Kokhba, an Antichrist of that day who's a type of the Antichrist to come. I'd refer you to my book, Shadows of the Beast. We go into it in greater depth. However, it's just there. John punctuates his gospel with these eschatological references. Another place John does this, although there's no Olivet Discourse, is in John 16. Turn with me, please, to John chapter 16. John 16 is one of the most important and underemphasized texts dealing with the return of Jesus in Scripture. People look at 2 Thessalonians, they look at the book of Revelation, they look at Matthew 24, 25, Luke 21, all this, and rightly so, but they ignore, or generally tend to ignore, John 16. John 16 is absolutely vital. Remember, John is the apostle who wrote the most about the return of Jesus. John wrote the most about the return of Jesus. Let's look. I'm going to begin in verse 1. Taute leleke humen hine me scandaloste ite. These things I've talked to you that you may not be scandalized, literally trapped. A wrong understanding of the return of Jesus has a way of spiritually and intellectually trapping people. They become ensnared by a false mindset. They can become entrapped by it. They're in a trap. The Greek word scandal doesn't exactly mean what it does in English. We usually think of it as something in the tabloids about politicians getting caught or something. It derives from that. But in Greek, it means ensnared, entrapped, okay, primarily, okay? That you will not be ensnared. Apostunagagas, you're going to be kicked out, apo, outside of the synagogue. Poesusin, humas, alekete horahine. Pasho, epaktines, humas doxe, letrian, prosphiron to theo. They'll kick you out of the synagogue, or you'll be led out of the synagogue forcibly, and they shall be doing this to you. Okay? There it is, it's future active, third person plural, to you. But is coming an hour that every, the one from killing you, should be seeming divine service. Latria, and we get the word latria in Latin. It's a Latin word that derives from a Greek word. Towards the carrying, prosphiron to theo. In other words, it's a general truth that they're going to kick you out of synagogues and things like this, but think they're serving God by doing it. But there's going to be a specific hour when this is going to intensify and become unique. Something that's always gone on is going to take on a unique dimension. It's going to have its climax or apex at some future point. Believers will always have tribulation, but all this tribulation will have a future apex at the end of the age. Believers will always be kicked out of, in this case, Jewish believers, kicked out of synagogues, but it will have an apex at the end of the age. Okay? Have an apex at the end of the age. Okay. Well, let's continue. That when they even kill you, apoktenes, one from killing, this is an aorist active nominative singular, let me kill you. Now we normally think of this as Islamic. We're going to kill the infidel, or if a Muslim becomes a Christian, we're going to behead them and things like this, in Saudi Arabia and things like this. I was just in Saudi Arabia, they actually do that to Christians. With the blessings of the American government. Nobody says anything. This goes on, okay? Or we think of what happened to Stephen, when they stoned Stephen, okay? It's not just going to be the Muslims or the Orthodox Jews. You're going to have people claiming to be Christians who are going to persecute true believers, thinking that they're honoring God. Thinking that they're honoring God. Today, if you stand up and speak out against same-sex marriage, you're going to have people claiming to be Christian. They're going to come after you and think that God's on their side. Story continues. Verse 3. Kaitelte poisonin humen hoti och egnosin ton patera, aude eme, and they shall be doing to you, because they not know the Father, not yet me. That term, aude, we mistranslate it, nor me, or they know not, let's see how you, they, these things they do to you because they have not known the Father nor me. Mistranslation. They not yet know me. Remember, he's speaking to a Jewish constituency.
Yeah.
A time will come when the Jews will know him. They'll look upon him who they have pierced. You understand? The implication, and more than the implication, the meaning of the Greek is a time is going to come when it's not going to be the case because they will know him. The Jews will know he's the Messiah at the end of the age. Zechariah 12:10, etc. Okay? It's not like they don't know the Father nor me. It's not they don't know the Father because they don't know me yet. Okay? That's the meaning of the Greek text. Okay? Continuing in verse 4. Ele taute veleke humin hine hotan efehe hora. Menomamote autohoti ego iron humin taute de humin ek arkes uch eron hoti met humon emen. These things, or these, I have talked to you that whenever may be coming the hour, again, he's referring to a specific hour. He's not just speaking generally. He's speaking both generally, but with the focus on the apex, on the coming climax of this, okay? He's referring to something at the end of the age. That when may be coming this hour, in other words, if you're one of the ones who happen to be here at that time, okay? You may be remembering, again, it's present active, second person plural, that you may be remembering of them that I said to you. Remember these things if you're around when this stuff happens. Is it a general truth for all believers at all time? Yes. Was it a truth for those believers at that time in the first century? Yes. But it becomes highly specific for the believers at the end of the age, that hour, you understand? In Midrash, this is called Kal V'Homer, Kal V'Homer. St. Paul was educated in the Midot of Rabbi Hillel. Kal V'Homer means light too heavy. Things that are true in a light situation become accentuated, amplified, take on a heavier dimension of importance in a heavy situation. Kal v'homer. Example. This is frequently used in end time prophecy. Hebrews 10:25. Forsake not the fellowshipping together one with another, especially as you see the day approaching. Fellowship is always important, but in the last days, it becomes highly important. Okay? Highly important. Kal v'homer, the general truth, takes on an expanded importance in a heavy situation such as the last days. Everybody understand? It's using kal v'homer. Jesus and Paul taught the way the other rabbis of the day did. They taught within that cultural context. Okay. Now let's begin looking. That you may be remembering them. I said these things to you at the beginning because I was with you. Let's continue. Verse 5. Nunde hupego proston pempsanta mikai odes echumon eroteme pau hupagais. Now I am going away, or I'm under the leading of going away. Pros towards the sending me. and not yet one out of you is asking me. Roughly translated, but now I'm going to where I'm going to go, or I'm heading to where I'm going to go, more accurately, and none of you ask me, where are you going? Verse 6. But because I have said these things, sorrow has of you the heart. By implication, filled the heart. Sorrow has filled the heart. Pepiroken. Sorrow has filled your heart. In Greek, this is nominative. It means as a direct object, it's singular. It doesn't just mean you're sorry about it. It means there's a consuming sorrow. There's a consuming sorrow. It's something that consumes you completely, spiritually and emotionally. It's an all-consuming sorrow that he was going away, but they didn't quite get it yet. Verse 7. Al egoten eleithion lego humen sumferai humen hine ego apetho. Pay attention. Ian gar me apetheo ho parakolitos auk elusetai pros humos ian de proithro Pimpo auto pros humas. But I, the truth, am saying to you, it is sumphirai. You could translate it expedient for you. Expedient for you. It's active, third person singular. But it's in the present tense. It's presently to your advantage that I may be coming away. Now, the idea is, I'm not going away, I'm coming away. His focus is always on heaven. The term in Greek is never, I'm going, it's I'm coming away. Our focus has to be the same. It's not that we're leaving here. Our focus has to be where we're going. When Jesus spoke of this, he never put the focus on, we're leaving here, even though we are. The focus is on, we're going home. The focus is on the destination. Okay, it's interesting the way, it's difficult to translate these things in a translation. I'm trying to tell you what it actually says and means from the original language, but it doesn't come across that well in translations as we would prefer it does. It's not the focus is, I'm coming. It's where the focus is on where we're going, not where we're leaving. Okay? But now he says this. Parakletos, next to the Consoler, the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit. Auk elusete, not shall be coming pros towards you, pros humas. Again, ien ger me. Now, in Thessalonians, it was ien ger me apelto. Ian ger me apertho here, okay. But in Thessalonians, it's Ian me elthe. Same terms. Almost the same identical phrase. Pay attention. Comparing John 16 with 2 Thessalonians. If this doesn't happen, that can't happen. If I don't go, he can't come. If he doesn't go, I can't come. You understand? I know you're going to be sorry I'm leaving, but if I don't go, he can't come. The converse at the end of the age. If he doesn't go, I can't. Now we need to qualify this carefully, very carefully. Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. It doesn't say the restrainer, the cantico, is taken. It says he ceases to restrain. It doesn't say that Jesus is going. It says he's coming. He is never taken from his people. The Holy Spirit is never taken from his people. But he is taken from the world. You understand? He is taken from the world. I'll never leave or forsake you. Now here's where these people go wrong. Their eschatology becomes convoluted because their pneumatology is convoluted. In other words, because they see hyper-charismatics and money preachers and lunatics in Toronto and Pensacola and all this garbage and all this counterfeit charismata, they see this neo-Montanism, they see this charismania, they tend to become cessationist. They adopt the false teaching that the gifts of the Spirit ended with the apostles and things like that. So therefore, they assume if the Holy Spirit is taken, the church must be taken. They deny anything like baptism of the Spirit. Okay. Look with me, please, in the same gospel, John chapter 20. Verse 22, and when he had said this, he breathed on them, pneumatos, and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. At that point, the apostles became regenerate. The Messiah died, took their sin to give them his righteousness and us, rose from the dead to give them eternal life, having died their death to give them and us his life. At that point, they became born again, regenerate, receive the Spirit, okay? Pentecost is different. Pentecost is when the church was empowered to preach the gospel to the world. The apostles already had the Holy Spirit indwelling them before Pentecost. But the church was not empowered to preach the gospel to the cosmos, to the world, to the lost, until Pentecost. Do not mistake the work of the Holy Spirit in the hearts of the regenerate, of God's people, of the saved, with his work in convicting the world or empowering the church to reach the world. They're two different functions of his Spirit. I'll never leave you or forsake you. When he ascended, he was still with them. They still had his Spirit. But the church was not empowered to reach the world. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 10, in the days of Noah, Jesus reminded us in the Olivet Discourse, the end of the age shall be just like the days of Noah. He was emphatic. Not like, but just like the days of Noah. Okay. In the days of Noah, my Spirit will not forever strive with man. A time is going to come when God says, that's enough. The age of grace will come to an end. Now, the subject of my next book, Lord willing, when I get around to writing it, I'm going to write it in Israel, Lord willing, is no bomb in Gilead, what really happens after the rapture. Remember, no matter what anybody tells you, no matter what the pre-trib people try to tell you, once the faithful church is raptured and resurrected, once the episynagogy happens, Once the harpazo happens, and the wrath of God is poured out on the day of the Lord, once that happens, the overwhelming mass of what both testaments teach shows that God has turned his purposes back to the salvation of Israel and the Jews. He refocuses centrally on Israel and the Jews. The time of the nations is over. The time of the Gentiles is over. The age of the church, per se, has come to a close. Once the faithful church is out of here, he's dealing again with Israel. And he's dealing with Israel. You got the temple, the whole bit. In Old Testament Israel, the Holy Spirit was only for certain people at certain times. Remember, high priests, kings, prophets, patriarchs, and judges. That's all. Certain people at certain times. God is going to go back to dealing with Israel and with the nations the way he did in the Old Testament. There'll be no more grace. Will the Holy Spirit still be here and be operative? Yes, in the sense he was in the Old Testament. You understand? Now, he will pour out his Spirit on Israel, won't he? Zechariah 12:10. There will be another Pentecost, as it were, for Israel and the Jews. That is true when they look upon him who they have pierced. But most, not all, but most of what the Word of God shows us is he's now going back and dealing with Israel in what's known as the Tekufat HaTzarat Yaakov, the time of Jacob's trouble, the darkest hour of their history. Forget all of this pre-trib rubbish. When the rapture happens, it's going to herald a great revival. The book of Revelation tells us when these terrible things happen, men still would not repent of their wicked deeds. This is all a fantasy. It's all a silly, ridiculous myth that is exegetically unsupportable. You must take on their nonsensical and unsubstantiated presuppositions to accord any plausibility to what they're saying. It's just not there. It's just not there. When you ask them, they can't. It's like talking to a Darwinist. You ask a Darwinist. Well, there was no information science when Darwin was around. Now we know there's no auto-encryption. If you have a computer program that writes another computer program, somebody still had to write the master program and figure, there had to be an intelligence to figure out the algorithms. It just doesn't work. Information cannot come from a vacuum. Says information science. You're telling me it does. You go to the Caltech. You walk from the Faculty of Information Science, there's no auto encryption. You walk across the campus to the Faculty of Biomedical Sciences, yes, there is. Which is right. You got a computer program with 100,000 lines of coded information, of digital information. That's massive. The human genome, just the human genome, is 13 billion. How did it come to, with the nucleotide sequencing, how did it come if there's no pre-existing intelligence? How did you get this encryption? They can't answer it. Well, the preacher people are the same. They can't answer it. How can you justify that presupposition? They can't answer it. And they come up with ridiculous things. It began with Watson and Crick in the 50s, but you had that other arrogant Englishman, Dawkins, saying, well, perhaps extraterrestrial life seeded the earth with nucleic acids, with recombinant material. They don't believe in God, but they believe a flying saucer came and put DNA in it. They become absurd in what they say. Pre-trib people become no less absurd in what they say. If men did not repent of their evil deeds and it just got worse, how can you say it's going to be a great revival after the rapture? There's no logic to it. How can they think that way? Because they have been ensnared. They are trapped. people were taught Darwinism. They were taught these things by their own professors in university. Now they're the professors. They're locked into the system. So people were taught these things in Dallas Theological Seminary or someplace, and they have to hold on to it because they're trapped in the system. Same thing. It's unbelievable. How much time do I have, John?
20 minutes.
I have 20 minutes more to go. Okay. Now, let's look at verse 8 of John 16. Kai elthon, ekenos, elekai, ton kosmon, peri armatias, kai peri dikas tousinis, kai peri chrysos. And coming, that is the Holy Spirit, or the paraclete, shall be exposing the system about missing and about missing the sin as missing the mark, hamartino, and about justice and concerning judgment or judging in Greek. It's genitive singular. Let's understand what it's saying here. The Holy Spirit for believers functions as a parakletos, a paraclete, the one who gets next to us, encourages, guides us, who guides, encourages, and supports us, gets next to us. That's how he functions for us, parakletos. For the world, he functions as an eklektos, the convictor. The convictor. For us, the parakletos. For the world, the eklektos. We must understand he does not function for us the way he does for the world, and he does not function for the world the way he does for us. He functions in two different ways. He deals with the world, but he deals with us. He's never taken from us. He'll always be the paraclete. Jesus said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. He'll always be there. But he won't function for the world the way he does now. And he will not empower the church or unite the church to deal with the world. A time is coming. As Daniel said, a shattering of the power of the holy people. I only mention that in passing. You can get the books. Now let's listen. You understand there's two different functions. For the believers, it's the parakletos. For the world, it's the eklektos, the convictor. When he comes, he's going to convict the world. Now, computer screens keep jumping around. He's going to convict the world concerning righteousness and judging. Next verse, 9. Peri harmatias men hoti o pistuosin es eme peri dikiesunes de hoti proston patera mu hupego kai och eti theorete me. Of sin, because they don't believe in me, or they believe not on me. Okay. And of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Because Jesus is with the Father, he is not here to point out man's sin as he did when he was alive. That becomes the function of the Holy Spirit. Okay. He convicts them of sin because they don't believe in him. Okay. When we get saved, okay, when we get saved, the Holy Spirit continues to deal with us but not in the way he deals with the world. They need this eklinktos, this conviction of their sin. The believer already knows we have sin. He begins dealing with us as the paraclete. You know, Felix, you're messing up here. That's the old nature. You know, Judy, you're a nice girl and everything, but, you know, you really blew it this afternoon. That's the old creation. You know. He deals with us differently than he does the world. That doesn't mean there will not be correction and things like that by any means. But he deals with his children different than he does with the world. These three things are how the Holy Spirit is the catechol. There are three primary things that restrain evil. Three primary things that in some way restrain evil in the broad sense. One is human government. I don't like politicians. I don't like Bush. The Saudi Arabians carried him around in his back pocket. In the back pocket, I didn't like Bush. I don't like Obama. He lit up the White House with the colors of the gay flag and all almost. I don't like Clinton. I don't like these guys. Praise God for Isaiah 9:6. The government will be upon his shoulders. No more politicians. But if these guys, even the ones I don't like, and there's not many of them that I do like, if they are not influenced by our prayers, they will be influenced by something worse. You understand? There's a spiritual, the book of Daniel deals with this fairly extensively. There's a spiritual battle over government. If these politicians, even though we don't like them, if they are not influenced by our prayers, they're going to be influenced by something worse. That's the first. This goes back to the time of Noah. Second thing, the empowering of the church to preach the gospel. A gospel-preaching church. That functions as a moral preservative, salt and light. Okay, second. Third, the catechol, the restrainer, the Holy Spirit. He does this by convicting the cosmos, the world, or it could be translated the system, of sin, righteousness, and judgment. When Antichrist comes, full or very nearly total or very nearly total political dominion will be given into his hand. Governance. As far as the church, the salt will have lost its taste. The church will have gone so far into apostasy, it is no longer salt and light, and the faithful church will be persecuted, relegated to the status of an underground church. Okay. That will be the way the embryonic church was before Pentecost. Remember, they had no power. They were just there waiting for something to happen. A time is going to come at the end where between the ascension and Pentecost, the believers were just waiting for the Spirit to come, but they couldn't do anything. Work while you have the light. Night will come, no man can work. Okay, that's going to happen again. We won't be able to do anything but wait. They were waiting for the Spirit to come. We'll be waiting for Jesus to come physically. Understand? Pentecost is reversed. Comparing the Greek text again. In 2 Thessalonians, Ian me erthi. In John chapter 16, Ian germe. Aperto. This can't happen until that one happens. He can't come until I go. I can't come until he goes. Not from your heart, but from the world. They've had it. I've had it with them. The age of grace. The nations have had their chance. Now I'm going back to my ancient people, Israel. That's what's going to happen, essentially. Let's continue looking at this. These three ways he functions are going to stop. These three ways that he presently functions are going to stop. Well, let's look further. He's no longer going to restrain. He'll be here, but not for the world, only for us. And we won't exist the way we do now. We will not be empowered to preach the gospel as we do now. For us to preach the gospel now, for an unsaved person to come to faith, there must be an eclectic. They must be convicted of their sin by the Spirit to come to God's grace and salvation. That's going to end. He goes back to the God of wrath the way he was in the Old Testament. He literally scares, terrifies people. Well, let's continue. Verse 12. Ete pole echo, legion humin, alo duneste. You'll be empowered. Bastasien arti. I am having to be saying to you, but you're not able to be bearing it at present. There's more stuff I want to tell you, but you can't handle it right now. He told them, there's more stuff I want to tell you about this, but you can't handle it right now. The implication is there's going to be a time when we can handle it. Remember in Daniel, these things are sealed to the time of the end. Now, he gets to this. He begins explaining what it is. How much time I have, John? Verse 13. Hotan de efe, ekenos tonumates, aletheus. Hadegese humas es pasan, ten alethien, alger lalese. Afhuto alhosa an acuse lalese, kaite ercomena, anagelai humen. Whenever yet may be coming, in other words, whenever this thing is going to happen that you can't handle right now, that one, that is the spirit of truth. Numa tes alethes. Remember, the Holy Spirit is the spirit of truth, not the spirit of error. One of the lies you see is the ecumenical seduction. You put truth on the back burner for the sake of an artificial unity. For instance, how many people here in the American Midwest, would be a number, how many people here are ex-Catholic, former Roman Catholic? Put your hand up a little bit higher, please. Okay. At some point in your life, you came to realize as a believer, the blood of Christ cleanses from all sin. You're not going to atone in purgatory for your own. The Roman Catholic doctrine of salvation rejects the sufficiency of the cross. Roman Catholicism requires some kind of auto-atonement. The blood of Christ does not cleanse from all sin in Roman Catholicism. There's some kind of a purgatorial cleansing or purging of some kind. Okay. Okay. Oh, we have to put that aside and just focus on love. Be one in the Spirit. That's not the Holy Spirit. That is the Spirit. That is not God's Spirit. God's Spirit depends on truth. He's the Spirit of truth, not of error. You cannot have unity of the Spirit where truth is sacrificed or compromised to attain this unity. You might wind up with some kind of religious stupidity that people are calling unity. Interfaith and all this. You get in bed with the Pope, he's in bed with the Dalai Lama. We're all one, hallelujah. But you're not going to have the unity of the Spirit. He's the Spirit of truth. When there's a fundamental breach of biblical dogma, a fundamental truth is compromised or sacrificed in any way, God's Spirit is not there. That is not the Spirit of Jesus. Okay. Now let's look at this. When this Spirit of truth comes, hodegese, it's future active, third person singular, it shall be the way leading, or shall be guiding you into pasan ten aletheon, into every truth. Translated all truth, but it means each individual doctrinal truth he's going to illuminate for us. Each one. And not for it shall be talking from self, but Jose, whatever it should be hearing, akose, it shall be talking, lelese. The Holy Spirit never speaks for himself. He only speaks for Jesus. The Holy Spirit is the true vicar of Christ. The Roman papacy replaces the Holy Spirit with a man. You understand? The Pope claims to be the vicar of Christ, Vicarius Christus in Latin. He's putting himself in place of the Holy Spirit. You understand? The church will tell you what the truth is. No, the Holy Spirit tells us what the truth is. He will lead you into all truth, but it's specific truths about the end of the age. He's going to lead you into this stuff. Now, again, we had the word apokalypson, unveiling. The Antichrist will be unveiled. Remember, there is no truth that's new. It's already in there. What apocalypse means is it's on back of the curtain. I have explained this many times, but I'll say it once again for the camera and for those watching on live streaming. For the faithful church, the closer we get to the return of Jesus, the more the curtain goes up. For the apostate church, the closer we get to the return of Jesus, the more the curtain goes down. The unfaithful church will understand less and less. The faithful church will understand more and more. The apostate church, it will become more and more blurred. For the faithful church, the definition will become more and more clear. You understand? In the last days, understanding becomes the barometer of faithfulness. Remember in Daniel, none of the wicked will understand? Laodicea, buy salve to anoint your eyes that you may see. The gauge, the plumb line, the measuring stick of faithfulness will be understanding. When you see people saying stuff like, we don't need to worry about that, we just have to love, you know. That's not the love of the Lord. Now, he doesn't speak for himself. Look with me, please, very briefly, to Luke chapter 12.
Jacob, we're going to take a break here in just a moment.
Should you give me no more than 5 minutes?
What do you think, folks?
Yes. Yes.
Oh.
Okay. I've been outvoted.
All right.
Absolutely, brother.
5 minutes.
Luke chapter 12. Let's look at verse 12. The Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. He doesn't speak for himself. We won't speak for ourselves. But he will still be here with us, not with the cosmos. He will not be here with the cosmos. There is no other possibility than the Catechol being the Holy Spirit. This can't happen until that does. Same terminology, same words in Greek. I can't come until he goes, because he couldn't come until I went. Not from you, but from the world. Amen. He can't come until I'm out of here. I can't come until he's out of here. He's the restrainer. Now, what these people do, of course, because of their cessationism, they say, well, if the Spirit's taken, the church must be taken. That's not true. The believers were here before Pentecost, and they had the Holy Spirit. They just couldn't do anything in dealing with the world yet. They weren't united or empowered, and God was not convicting them. The same thing happens. That's exactly what it means. Now, I would appeal to our pre-wrath brethren who are very, very close to what we believe. As a matter of fact, my own position, which people call intra-seal, is virtually the same as pre-wrath, except on this one main issue and a few other lesser important points. You've mainly got it right, but you got this point wrong. The catecho, the restrainer, is without doubt or question the Holy Spirit. We'll continue in the second half. God bless. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Who feels blessed today? Who's been getting fed this morning? This is great.
Can I ask an obnoxious question just for my own benefit?
Please.
Different groups vary. Do you people find the Greek boring? Me translating from the Greek?
No.
This was awesome, brother.
All right.
We're going to take a quick offering, and then I got some instructions for you as we're going to take a break immediately following that offering. But once again, just for anyone who wonders today, this offering is to offset the conference expenses.